The most exciting thing about the ministry here in Honduras is for them to understand that Jesus Christ is all that they need. I'm a Bible teacher at a private bilingual Christian school, and about 95% of the students there at the school are Honduran. Their parents are doctors and business owners and politicians and are very, very high up in society. So the students that are in my classes, they most likely are going to grow up to do very similar things as their parents. And many of the students have very poor relationships with their families. And so even though they may have been brought to church for their entire lives and they know the right answers, sometimes the right answers don't line up for what they've seen in their lives. For some of them, they trust in Him for the first time for their salvation. Others of them understand that even though they've been a Christian for many, many years, they don't have to continue to have a works life in order to earn God's favor. They're going to be the ones making decisions that are going to change and impact this culture for better or for worse. And our hope and our goal is to teach them while they're young that living for the Lord is the best way, and that the corruption that has gone on in this country for years and years and years can be stopped with the power of God.
I didn't really see the need, the poor, the poverty. My students didn't let me see that. But when I started living there, God showed me the total need. The street kids, little children, like 7, 8 years old, holding babies, and men who were using them to do that. Mothers with babies, pregnant ladies. It was unbelievable. And I just really knew that was what God was calling me to do. And my heart really went out to the girls, because I would just see them with kind of old men who were sleeping off their vodka, kind of the kids were living underground in the manholes. And under there they get raped and abused pretty bad. So they had the stairwells to sleep in, they had the manholes to sleep in, both places where they would be abused by men, usually drunken men, or they would end up as prostitutes because, and they still do, because that's a way to get warm.
The first time she told me about God, and I was wondering if she's really caring about me and talking about God, or is she just trying to put me in her religion. I was very suspicious in my heart and wondering. So what has changed in my life is the knowledge about God. Even I don't know a lot about God. The environment, the condition that I grown up was really bad, dark, horrible. So because of that, I was looking into the life really depressive way. But now I have a big hope and I look into the life with bright eyes. Yeah. I have changed a lot, and now I know that through the God's bless and grace, I know that there is a purpose in my life. But even I don't know what is my exact purpose, I will try my best, and with the help of my dear teachers, I will find it out.
We have to share the good news with them, with those children. And we have to tell them about who's Jesus. This is the only one thing we have to do. If we can give that word, that means our work is accomplished.
As the families improve, this should not be a needy area in 10, 20 years, you know? My thinking is they've gone through Head Start program, which one of their kids is gonna go to university, you know? And how are we gonna make it really long-lasting. And I hope, on the bottom line, somebody else with different gifts than mine will come and replicate the next one.
Because in my mind, I came to Mongolia to help starving kids. I felt inadequate to teach the Bible. But God loves to use us in our inadequacies.
Radio sails, radio sails. Let us shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night.
I'm sure that I'm going to get a lot of people come in from the countryside after that hard winter. You know, let's say they're 40 years old and they've raised goats their whole life. How are you going to get a job in the city if your only qualifications is you know how to milk a goat? Now the men have no purpose. They turn to alcohol because you can buy a big bottle of alcohol for 40 cents. So we have to get to them individually because no state program is going to fix this. So any kid that's going to enter the public school system in the fall can come in the spring and they can get an opportunity to learn their letters and numbers and songs and different things that they're going to need to know. There's a good chance they may have never even held a pencil before. The majority of the children that we have come through the Head Start program go right to the top of their class and they stay there. Last year we paid over 40 college tuitions for kids to go to college.
It's to get any job here you need to have a university.
And the other thing that's going to help is another thing that we do here, which is we teach English. We offer free conversational English where I gather all the foreigners I can find. And we come up here on Saturdays and we just have a conversation with them because most of the kids have gone and they've learned English in school, but they learned it out of a textbook by usually Russian teachers or something. So they've never really had an opportunity to speak it. And so being able to come up here and talk with foreigners from every country in the world every week, if they see a foreigner on the street, they're not as embarrassed to have a conversation with them. And then that's going to get them the job.
It was a terrible story. They had a really nice life, but the father died of pneumonia. And then after the father died, the mother started drinking. And then she got into a knife. Someone knifed her. It was a drinking fight. And someone actually slit her open and left her to die. Like, her intestines are all messed up. She has a very sick person. Their house had burnt down. Their little boy had been burnt so badly. The trauma of everything that happened in his life, he quit talking. He felt like a speech impediment, actually. And he got kicked out of school. The teachers said, "We don't want you here anymore." We were driving home going, okay, it's going to get really cold in the next 2 days. These guys are going to freeze to death. What do we do? That's how it was birthed. This is what we really actually need is an emergency hasha. It is so much about building relationships and having a deep relationship with these people. And it takes a lot of time.
We have to get to them individually because no state program is going to fix this.